Got the thumbs up. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to weekly worship at St. Mary's on August 23rd. It's nice to have everybody here today who's going to join in. We're going to start with a little bit of music as people get settled in. It's kind of gray day, so it feels a bit gray, actually. So that's okay. We could be sort of grayish together.
Good morning, everyone. I don't have my phone with me today, so I can't really see who's coming. I saw Rob. Rob wished everyone good morning in German. That's because it's the Champions League final today.
Oh my gosh, we go with the sports again.
That's
hello,
right.
Rob.
We should sing Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Guten Morgen?
Yes.
Very good. All right, we're going to sing Alleluia, Sing to Jesus. Full disclosure, I don't usually sing along with y'all when we do this. We do this at the early service because it's very high for me. So I will do my best. Usually I let Claire do it from the congregation. But you can still enjoy it, even though it's a little bit high up there. I might bring some of the sunshine to our gray. All right, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Hallelujah, is our treasure.
Is it possible you transpose it down a bit usually?
Usually
as well?
I also play it on the keyboard and I transpose it down. That's a thing. But never mind.
I think I might have picked up different words for the third verse after all.
I didn't think those were the normal verses.
I confess. Let's pray and then confess, for real.
For real.
When does an ordinary life become extraordinary? A mundane day become revolutionary? A moment in time change history? When God enters in, forgives sin, allows us to begin again. When we repeat those words of Mary, may it be to me as you say. And the confession. To the Lord our God belong mercies and forgivenesses, though we have rebelled against him. Neither have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his laws which he set before us. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Almighty God, have mercy upon us. Pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and keep us in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. We're going to sing now a song called Light of the World, which was requested by Richard. This was our Advent theme song last year. So it's kind of a Christmas song, but he was like, there's reason and purpose, we should do this song. So being the flexible kind of person that I am, I said, of course we will do a Christmas song. But it's very lovely. It's by Lauren Degler, the same one who does Rebel Heart and You Say and Rescue. We're going to sing Rebel Heart later too. Now we're going to sing Light of the World.
You want to know the reason?
Did you want to say that now?
Sure.
Go.
There's a theological reason and a pragmatic reason.
Okay.
So the theological reason is that in Advent, we celebrate Christ coming in three ways. In the stable at Christmas, in our hearts every day, and at the end of time.
Oh.
So you can actually celebrate looking forward to Christ coming whenever you like.
I suppose. But if we broke out into We Three Kings, it would probably not fill people's...
What set my mind on a Christmas track, that you said you had three kings in the mind. And more pragmatically, it feels like a little bit of hope and looking for angels and a sea of hurt is kind of where we are at the moment.
Agree. little bit of hope, oh come, Emmanuel.
Almighty God, unto whom will hearts be open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love thee, and worthily magnify thy holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, we are taught by your word that all our doings without love are worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtue, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen. Our psalm this morning is number 138. These are so pretty. I just need to say, these are like my favorite. I have lots of favorites. Thank you. Everything in me says thank you. Angels listen as I sing my thanks. I kneel in worship facing your holy temple and say it again, thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your faithfulness. Most holy is your name. Most holy is your word. The moment I called out, you stepped in. You made my life large with strength. When they hear what you have to say, God, all earth's kings will say, thank you. They'll sing of what you've done, how great the glory of God. And here's why. God, high above, sees far below. No matter the distance, he knows everything about us. When I walk into the thick of trouble, keep me alive in the angry turmoil. With one hand strike my foes, with your other hand save me. Finish what you started in me, God. Your love is eternal. Don't quit on me now.
And the reading from Isaiah. Listen to me, all you who are serious about right living and committed to seeking God. Ponder the rock from which you were cut, the quarry from which you were dug. Yes, ponder Abraham, your father, and Sarah, who bore you. Think of it, one solitary man when I called him, but once I blessed him, he multiplied. Likewise, I, God, will comfort Zion, comfort all her mounds of ruins. I'll transform her dead ground into Eden, her moonscape into the garden of God, a place filled with exuberance and laughter, thankful voices and melodic songs. Pay attention, my people. Listen to me, nations. Revelation flows from me. My decisions light up the world. My deliverance arrives on the run, my salvation right on time. I'll bring justice to the peoples. Even faraway islands will look to me and take hope in my saving power. Look up at the skies. Ponder the earth under your feet. The skies will fade out like smoke. The earth will wear out like work pants, and the people will die off like flies. But my salvation will last forever. My setting things right will never be obsolete. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We sang this song for the first time last week. I hope you found it very singable. So we'll do it again maybe for the next couple of weeks also to let it settle in a little bit. It's called Be Still. Oh, there we go.
Still and know that I
If it wasn't Facebook, it would feel right to just be silent for a while. But I don't know how that comes across when we do Facebook. I don't know if being silent for a while is weird. You can let us know. Being still is good. The gospel this morning is in the book of Matthew, chapter 15. When Jesus arrived in the villages of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "What are people saying about who the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some think he is John the Baptizer, some say Elijah, some Jeremiah, or one of the other prophets." He pressed them, "And how about you? Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter said, "You're the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus came back, "God bless you, Simon, son of Jonah. You didn't get that answer out of books or from teachers. My Father in heaven, God himself, let you in on the secret of who I really am. And now I'm going to tell you who you are, really are. You are Peter, a rock. This is the rock on which I will put together my church, a church so expansive with energy that not even the gates of hell will be able to keep it out. And that's not all. You will have complete and free access to God's kingdom. He's to open any and every door. No more barriers between heaven and earth, earth and heaven. A yes on earth is yes in heaven. A no on earth is a no in heaven." He swore the disciples to secrecy. He made them promise they would tell no one that he was the Messiah. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you,
Lord
Jesus Christ.
I never understood why he swore them to secrecy. I never got that. Not that you necessarily have the answer, but I'm just saying.
No, if Walter would like to write me one of his excellent emails.
Yeah, Walter might know.
No, actually, Walter didn't write me a good email last week.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, I think I might have strayed dangerously close to saying that Christ sinned last week, and that's not sound. Because we did say Jesus was a bit grumpy.
Right. But is grumpy necessarily sinning?
Well, that's a good question.
I don't know.
That's a good question.
Yeah.
And Walter wrote me a very good email, which I've been very busy this week, actually, Walter. I didn't quite get to it. But if you want to write as to why these things were to be kept secret, let me know. My theory is that the time was not right. And actually, he was in Caesarea Philippi.
Yeah.
That was Gentile country, or not Jewish country.
Yeah.
Which emphasized two things, one of which it emphasized was what we talked about last week, that his mission was for the world, not for just the Jews.
Yeah.
And the other thing is because it had Caesar in the title, Caesarea Philippi.
Yeah, yeah.
Just in case you didn't get that.
I did.
You might have expected that to be a place where you would make political statements, but his political statement was that this was not a political statement. So he wasn't going there to raise an army, to march on Jerusalem, to throw the Romans out, etc.
Okay.
And one of the reasons he might have sworn them to secrecy is if word got out that he was the Christ, the Messiah, that people would have, without seeing the full thing unfold, they would get the wrong idea.
Okay.
But Walter, please feel free to email. I will be glad to receive it. It's a very short reflection today, actually.
That's okay.
I think it is. Peter had a good day and a bad day. You see, his good day was he had the insight given to him by God that Jesus was the Messiah, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Because this is actually a pivotal point in the gospel. So before this, it's all the teaching, it's all the healings, it's all the miracles. After this, it's really going to Jerusalem and all the events leading up to Holy Week.
Mm.
And as we talked about the last couple of weeks, he has kind of made things quite hot with his criticism of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and so on. So this is kind of the center point, as it were, of the gospel. And that center point is Peter realizing who Jesus really is. But lest we forget, immediately afterwards, so Jesus at that point was, way to go, Peter, that came from God, that's fantastic, and I'll build my church upon you, and this is how it will be. And Peter, don't forget, was an ordinary guy. He was a fisherman and a rough kind of guy. Then immediately afterwards, Peter says, but Jesus, you can't go to Jerusalem, presumably, so you'll be in danger there. And Jesus' response to that is, get thee behind me, Satan. Like, that's a temptation. That's not right.
Is that the next bit?
That's the next bit. That's okay. Immediately afterwards.
Right.
I guess it's probably the reading for next week, but I didn't check. But it's the rest of Matthew 16. So Peter had a good day and a bad day. At the same time. So if you've ever had a good day and a bad day and felt really high and then felt, ugh, maybe I got that a bit wrong, you're in good company. But it feels to me that like all of us have to get to the question, who do we think Jesus is? And how you answer that question is quite important. And for the astute, and for those who listened to Marie's talk about 2 years ago now, I guess, quite a lot of the talks take slightly the form what, so what, and now what. So what is the explanation, and then so what is, well, why does that matter? And then now what is, well, okay, what are you going to go do about it then? And it feels to me as though actually that question, who do you think Jesus is a really good what, so what, now what question. And worth all of us, you know, dwelling on from time to time. And because I had the Advent song in my head, I guess, it also made me think that it's a question, rather, that everyone has to answer for the first time. Obviously the first time you answer that question, really answer it for yourself rather than just repeating what somebody told you. And then maybe like the coming of Jesus in Advent, it's also a question that even if you have answered it once, it's a question that you should repeat and ask over and over again. Because, when you do know somebody, you know, you know somebody for a long time, you do find out different things about them. You see different aspects. People you've known a long while can still surprise you. And the relationship changes. That's just how life is. And I feel it's worth asking that question about Jesus as well.
Yeah.
And then ultimately, I guess, we will be asked that question when it comes to judgment, if that's where afterlife goes. So my very quick reflection for today is spend a bit of time this week asking yourself the question, who do I think Jesus is? And put it in the framework, what? So what is your understanding? What insights does that give you into God? So what? Does it matter to you? And now what? What do I do about that? And just remember as well that you might not be ready to answer that question, or you might think you've got a great answer for that question, but either way, it's worth revisiting from time to time.
Yeah.
That was pretty much it, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, I told you it was short today.
It's okay, it's a still sort of grey day. I mean, but that was interesting, I like that. It's good. It's a good way to frame it. Who do you say God is? Should we sing?
We should sing Rebel Heart.
We will.
Take my life and grant it me. Your take my life and grant it me. Your take my life and grant it me.
Let's pray. We pray for our own faith, for our own understanding of Jesus, our own understanding of God. The understanding in our hearts and the understanding in our heads. And we offer it. We offer our talents and we offer our gifts. And we pray for your guidance as we do study and pray and read. Show us a path. We pray for the church, the community of people who comes together trying to worship, trying to follow you. Pray for St. Mary's, for all that we do, for the work that people carry on, for the time people worship, for this, those who pray and support, those who study, those who work. We pray for our future, ours and all the other Anglican churches, as we figure out what's the best way of helping people worship in COVID times and beyond. And we pray for those who lead the church, for Bishop Mary, for Michelle, our Archdeacon. For those who are trying to figure out both how to share their own faith and their own journeys and how to encourage others to do the same. As we start to think about schools going back, we pray for families and teachers, and those in the education system. We know there's probably no right answer, Lord, but we pray for wisdom and for good sense, and also for acceptance and understanding. And pray for all the anxieties and the stresses that are out there. That you'll give a sense of peace to those who are just doing their best to try and do what needs to be done. And as we do week by week, we offer prayers for those we know who are sick in body, mind or spirit, offering their names to you out loud or in our hearts. Lord, use these hands to carry the burden. Use this voice to carry your word. Use these feet to walk in your footsteps. Use this heart to transform the world. And we say together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Amen.
May the peace of God reign in this place and in all our places, and the love of God forever hold you tight. May the Spirit of God flow through your life, and the joy of God uphold you day and night.
And now, as an outward and visible sign of what we hope and pray as an increasing inward and spiritual reality, we share the peace.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you. I practiced, because you said, you always remember it, and then I hesitated.
It does. The notices. The main notices, as you know, we've been doing this for a while now, and there's no real sign of not doing it for a while. And you know, some churches use Zoom, you know, have everybody doing the service by Zoom. But I actually quite like doing it the way we're doing it. It seems to me to be a bit more gentle and non-intrusive somehow.
I like because the door is wide open.
And the door is
anybody
wide open,
can,
exactly.
Which I think is important.
Nevertheless, a few folks did express the enthusiasm to chat a bit after the service, like we would sometimes do if we were just, you know, here in church as normal. So at the point where we've finished, Claire has very kindly volunteered to get a Zoom going. And the link is either on the Facebook page or in the email. I'm sure you can find it. So if you fancy just hanging around for a little bit afterwards and chatting and saying hi, just join the Zoom. There's no compunction, but it'd be great to chat. I think that's it.
Yeah. Was that really clear? Like, did that make sense?
Say it again.
Yeah. I was talking to somebody who goes to a different church, and this is what they do. They do the service part a little bit differently, but then afterwards there's a Zoom link that gets circulated for anybody who would like to join, and they have a little coffee hour after church in the hallway, and it seemed like a really nice idea, and it is a component that's missing from what we're doing on Sunday mornings, and so it felt like a good idea to try it. And so, like everything, on the first week, it's a little bit, we're not sure. And then I think in the future, you're not going to send the link the morning of, right? It's going to go in the regular email, because some people might not even have noticed they got an email this morning.
You got an email quite early this morning.
Yeah, and so the Zoom link is there, and we don't know if it's on the Facebook page as well.
It's absolutely on the Facebook page.
Oh, it is on the Facebook page. Okay, so if you want to click it on the Facebook page, you could probably find it.
It's in the comments to this service.
Wonderful and excellent. And so you can click it in the comments to the service, or you can find it in your email. And it's just going to be like a regular Zoom, and Claire's going to be there, and to open it, and then people can just chat. A bit like you did when you did your
the Zoom massage.
Yeah, it's just a little chance to get together and chat and just be and hear from each other.
That's right.
Cool.
Exactly. Thank you. Cool. I feel fuzzy this morning. That was much clearer. Thanks.
No, well, I don't know if it necessarily was, but anyways.
Anyway, Zoom afterwards if you want.
Exactly.
That's the simple bit.
And we'll try that for a while and see how people will find it. And do you need to give maybe any little update on what the plan is for September?
Oh, yeah.
I feel like that's probably on people's minds.
Yes. Well, I realize it's now August the 23rd.
It really is.
So we need to submit our plan to the diocese, which should be fairly straightforward, I think. And then the plan will be that the Sunday after Labor Day, I think probably at 4 p.m. in the afternoon.
When you say submit our plan to the diocese.
Okay.
Well, so, because otherwise people are going to
yes.
think.
So the way that the bishop has done it is she's correctly cautious, I think, and she doesn't want everybody just going and doing their own thing. So the bishop and the archdeacon, the executive archdeacon, sent out some guidelines and some rules. And what they've asked is that each church, before they reopen, submits a plan to say this is how we're going to handle people coming in, this is how we're going to make sure people are distanced from each other, this is how we're going to make sure that they don't hug or and so on. And phase two is you can come back and we can gather for sure, but only Marie will be allowed to sing, and you'll have to be further away from us than usual.
Mm-hmm.
And and we'll have to come in one way and leave the other way and all those other things I just said. And we have to submit a plan to say this is how we're going to do all that. Phase three does allow communion and some other things to go on, but you have to get kind of some practice with phase two first. Not just us, but I think the whole diocese, actually. So we will submit our plan, and then the aim will be on the second... And then, sorry, when we did that, like there's a lot of work that's going to go into that, so we're going to have to clean the church before and after the service, we're going to have to make sure that everything is disinfected, microphones are cleaned, and so on and so forth. So when we talked about that and also got feedback from people, it's a lot of work for the sort of numbers that we would usually get. So we thought, well, why don't we try it once a month to start with, see how that goes. And then hopefully more people will come. We'll put it on a Sunday afternoon, so hopefully there's a good. It's an easy time for people to get. So we'll try 4 p.m. the Sunday after Labor Day, just in case people are doing things Labor Day weekend.
Okay.
And I think the maximum number of people is 50, or half the capacity of the church, which I think will be 50 for us. I think it's the lower of those two numbers.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. So it'll be 50 people.
Okay.
We can't do kids stuff. That's not allowed, but we can have 50 people distanced and coming and worshipping, and I will try and get a clergy person to come and do it as well.
Okay, great. That was informative. Thank you. I learned some things too.
You're welcome. And Ardy, we need to talk about the plan.
Yeah.
And I'm also talking tomorrow on the telephone with Leah from Shea Doris.
Oh, great.
Fundraising and anything else we might like to do with them. And also, I'm actually quite interested to hear a bit more. Like, she told me a few things that Shea Doris is, they're doing their best, and now things are reopening a bit and they're kind of getting going again. But hopefully she'll tell me a few things about what's kind of really happening and what some of the problems they've really seen have been.
Okay, that's good.
I think that's it for my announcements. Yeah.
Okay, I can't think of anything else, so.
All right.
There was a request for Shine to Shine.
There was.
I don't usually sing this one either. I usually let you all sing this, and it gets really high by the end, too. I don't know what happened today, all these high songs. Anyways, I texted Daniel before the service to say, by the way, we're singing Shine to Shine, because...
I told him to.
Did you tell him to? Okay, because he likes Shine to Shine. And he actually replied at 9:30 in the morning, which is pretty good for an 18-year-old, saying great, but he didn't say he would be here. So, Daniel, I don't know if you're there, but you're supposed to be. We're going to sing Shine to Shine.
I'm allowed to leave my mic on, right?
If you want to. It's up to you. Okay, here we go.
Fill this land with the body's glory.
of the darkness shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me. Shine, Jesus, shine.
God the Father bless us. May Christ take care of us. The Holy Ghost enlighten us all the days of our life. The Lord be our defender and keeper of body and soul, both now and forever, to the ages of ages. And go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God. Thank you, everyone. Either see you at coffee or see you next week.